Young people, tell us something about the new Ansible AWS, the open source Ansible Tower, which was released half a year ago, something like that?
No, September.
September, oh.
Yeah, September, mid-September.
Yeah, they promised us January last year.
They were right.
Enjoy.
Thanks. Yeah, so good morning. Has anybody heard of Ansible Tower? Good. This is not a talk about Ansible Tower. This is a talk about Ansible AWX and AWX. And this, the phrasing is, I understand, very important from a legal point of view. Ansible AWX, by the way, that is the way it's pronounced. It's not AUX, it's AWX, is the what is officially called the upstream project from which Tower will then periodically, maybe every few months, be generated. So, de facto, it's more or less the same thing, but Ansible Tower remains a commercial product, remains a supported product. You have to purchase it, you have to purchase a license. It's not inexpensive, but you get support. And Ansible AWX is the open source code base from which Tower is then occasionally generated. And this upstream project, this Ansible AWX project, you all know me, right? Good. This Ansible AWX project was released, if I recall correctly, approximately September. And we've been waiting for it for a long time, at least I've been waiting for it for a long time. Not necessarily, I will admit, not necessarily because I would like to because I would like to use it. I'm a command line person. I want Ansible Playbook and I want Ansible and I want my shell. So I would hate to have to use something like Tower or like AWX, but I know that there are very, very many people who want to use it, and there are good, very good reasons for wanting to use it. And I hope to be able to show you a little bit, at least a few screenshots, and maybe whet, W-H-E-T, your appetite for having a look at AWX. Yes?
Does AWX mean something?
Yes, sir. It means, well, very loosely, Ansible Works. So Michael Dehaene, who created it, originally, when he created the company Ansible Works, this was before Ansible.com came around, was then asked, what does AWX mean? And he said, loosely, it means Ansible Works, but nothing really. So it doesn't, I suppose today we would say, it doesn't really mean anything. So the AWX project is an open source project. Its repository is at github.com/ansible/AWX. In parallel to Ansible. And so it's a first class Ansible project, it's a Red Hat project, and it is a web-based user interface with a REST API and a task engine built on top of Ansible. Now, one thing I would like to underline is the words REST API. What we frequently, or you might also have experience with that, what you frequently see is somebody has a product, and then they say, oh, we need a REST API, and then they bolt on something on the side, and they call that a REST API. The way AWX, and by extension, of course, Tower, everything that we say for AWX, almost everything we say for AWX also goes for Tower. The way that this project differs is that it started off with a REST API. So everything that we see in the user interface, and I'll be showing you some screenshots, is built on top of that REST API. So absolutely everything that we'll be seeing also exists as a REST API, which makes it highly interesting in as much as we can then interface AWX very easily with other systems we may have. You might have continuous integration systems or Jenkins or Rundeck or whatever they're all called, and you want to trigger things in Ansible AWX, that's almost trivial to do so.
You may want to configure AWX with Ansible.
You may want to configure AWX with Ansible. Not only that, you have to configure AWX with Ansible. There's only one way, one supported way to install AWX, and that is with Ansible. So why has Red Hat done this? Why has it open sourced AWS? Well, because they say that is what they do. They open source most of their products, so that is what they do. Now, if you've ever seen me talk about Ansible, and many of you have, or some of you at least have, you will recognize this diagram at least partially. And what we see here is, by the way, I want to clarify one thing. It's not I who stole this diagram from Toshan, okay? what we see here on the right are your nodes where we have, where we don't need to install agents, we don't need to install daemons, those are the machines that we actually will be implementing. Does anybody have a laser pointer by chance? I forgot mine, sorry. And on the top left, we have our hosts, our so-called inventory, we have our playbooks. And this diagram, when I speak about Ansible without AWX, thanks, Mark. This diagram, when I speak with, about Ansible, looks very similar. We have the inventory file that Toshan explained earlier, we have playbooks, and we have Ansible. And then here are the nodes that we will be configuring. Now, this has changed slightly. This box has a little bit of extra in it. We have AWX machine, and this AWX machine has Ansible with it. So we have AWX and Ansible together. Okay, they go hand in hand. So, what was that? We were talking about, Ansible normally using the Ansible inventory, and using playbooks. Playbooks are our recipes, as Toshan explained, the recipes that we will be, with that Ansible, will be applying onto nodes. And these nodes, those are the computers that we want to configure. We don't need any agents installing there. We don't need a daemon installing there. And Ansible speaks to these nodes via SSH. So this remains the same way. We still have Ansible talking to these nodes. But Ansible is now being driven by something called AWX. And AWX is going to take, or is going to use inventories. Here, slightly dotted, I'll explain why in a second. And it's going to use playbooks. And these come out of a software configuration management system, like, for example, a software control system, like, for example, Git or Mercurial or Subversion, whatever they're called, Bitbucket, etc. So, the important thing also is, as we'll be discussing and as you'll see later on, is that we have basically zero control over this machine. So this AWX is more or less sort of encapsulated, and we don't log into an AWX, we don't typically anyway log into an AWX machine. We do not typically create playbooks on the file system of an AWX machine. We do not typically We typically don't do anything on the AWX machine. Yeah? These are it's a completely closed environment. So feature-wise, what do we have? We have a dashboard. We have so-called real-time playbook output. I'll show you in a second what that means. I can't demonstrate it, unfortunately. I forgot my demo. We have a so-called push-button deployment. This button here that you'll see later on in smaller shape. We have integration with Galaxy. Everybody knows what Galaxy, Ansible Galaxy is? A role distribution platform where you get what you pay for. We have authentication, we have so-called projects, we have templates, we have jobs, we have security, notifications, logging. These are all things that Ansible AWX brings us, and I would like to at least introduce you to a number of these things. First of all, let's have a look at some of the user interface. What we see here, or what you see here, is the main, let's say, dashboard. Here on the left, you have a menu. This menu you can fold in by pressing that button there, and then you just have the icon, so it takes some less space. Then on the top, for those who can't read it because it's too small, we have 15 hosts, 0 failed hosts, 9 inventories in the system, 0 inventory sync failures, 4 projects, and 0 project sync failures. Here in the center, the job status. Everything you see here will change dynamically. So it's this interface uses WebSockets to speak to AWX, which is behind it. So as soon as the job is launched, you will see that job show up here. You will see the green job counter increase, or the red failed job counter increase, so things move, okay? So it's quite elegant, at least I find it's quite elegant. Here at the bottom, we have recently used job templates. A job template is what you and I on a command line would call a playbook, plus a little bit more. I'll show you in a second what that means. And you see a little green knob if the job was, the last job run was successful, and you see a little red knob if the job run was successful, obviously. And you see here the little rocket and a pencil. The pencil is edited the action, edit the job, and the little rocket is a push button deployment. So you press that, and then that job template, that playbook in effect, playbook plus a little bit extra, will run again with the same parameters. So for example, if a host failed for some reason because it wasn't there, you could run that job again and get that host found. First of all, if you have any questions, by the way, just interrupt me, okay? First of all, let's talk a little bit about authentication. AWX requires users to authenticate against it. If you want to access that dashboard, you have to log in. There are lots of different ways of authenticating for some reason. Well, I suppose because people wanted it, but you have the social authenticators, GitHub, Google, and co. You can authenticate via local data, so you have users installed in AWX, users with name and password, etc. You have then the enterprise connectors, LDAP, obviously, and by extension, Active Directory. You have SAML, you have Radius, even TACAX for a very strange reason, but it's there. And also, if you want Kerberos, which sadly is used very little, but no, let me rephrase that. Sadly, it's used only in the Windows world, which makes it even more perverse. So, security, we have playbooks, which are run by a particular user, that's the AWX user. They are executed in let's say, a jail, something like a jail, in namespaces, in change root environments. Important, one playbook cannot access data of another playbook. That is quite carefully and quite cleverly compartmentalized. And what we have is RBAC or role-based access control. That is, for example, I can create, and I'll show you an example right now, I can create a playbook, a job run template. And then we have here a user called Jane. And this user gets execute writes on a particular job. As soon as this user gets has this execute write, Jane could log into AWX and could launch this job template. And by the fact that she has execute write on a playbook, she automatically has execute write on the associated inventory and on all data that is associated with this run template, okay, with this job template. So it makes it very, very easy to create systems, for example, create a playbook and associated data, which is used by maybe first level support in the evening. Something goes wrong, you give them a button which they can press, and just by giving them execute write on a particular job template, what we would call a playbook, they can execute that, they can look at the log output. They cannot see the content of the playbook, they cannot see what inventory is being accessed. They can't see any hosts, they can't see any passwords, and no credentials whatsoever. They can only execute that playbook and see its output. Yes,
This is sort of authorization.
Yes.
And previous slide was authentication.
Yes.
Can you derive this authorization also from one of the sources of your authentication, like groups in your Active Directory?
Yes, you can. I can't say exactly how. No, I can't say exactly how, but I've not yet experienced it. You can, or we can, when we set up external authentication, or external authentication, for example, via LDAP, via Active Directory, we specify how groups are selected, which attributes, which LDAP directory attributes become groups, etc. And that has an effect in the, then later on here in the roles. Whether we can really sort of set it up in such a way that in LDAP, in Active Directory, you can say give that user execute rights, I must check. I don't know. I'll try and check later.
Access or admin is probably enough, but there's a lot of people in Active Directory that don't need to log into AWS at all.
Yeah, correct. But you would of course limit the number of people, or you would limit the people by be it a specific attribute or by group membership. You would limit who is actually allowed to log into AWS. Let me just, for those who are maybe not quite so firm yet, we look at this picture again. We need, Ansible needs, when it speaks to nodes, when we're going to configure nodes, Ansible needs to know what are the host names, how can it log in there, what can it do. And in order to know which hosts I have in my environment and how to actually reach these hosts, well, more or less how to reach these hosts, we use a so-called inventory. And this inventory is typically, by default anyway, /etc Ansible hosts can be changed, and it can also be a dynamic inventory, which means it you can have a script, you can have a program which, for example, accesses a database on LDAP directory server to actually obtain the inventory. This inventory is more or less sort of, when we use Ansible, we typically have one inventory, okay? And this one inventory describes our organization. Now, this is not 100% true. You can have an inventory per directory, you can have an inventory which you specify on the command line, so we can have a whole bunch of inventories. And this is also the case in AWX, but they look and feel a little bit differently, obviously, and that is through the nature or by nature of AWX being what it is. First of all, we have a number of different inventories. We can have multiple inventories, and these inventories can be imported. We can actually import via a special utility, which is a little bit messy, but we can actually import an inventory with all host vars, group vars, into the AWX database, which, by the way, is a Postgres database. We can have inventory files which are synchronized over, for example, a Git repository with AWX. So in a Git repository, you have a file which is called hosts, which is the Ansible any type inventory or YAML type inventory, which is then synchronized with AWX. You can have inventories sync in from Amazon Web Services, from Google Compute Engine, from Rackspace. You can have your custom inventory scripts, which you maybe use today with Ansible. You can use them unchanged, unmodified with AWX, and you can also exchange, you can either drag and drop them in, or you can actually exchange them via a Git repository. So there's a whole lot of different possibilities. And these inventories, you can, by the way, I don't know whether I said that, you can actually also create locally an inventory. You can say, I want to create an inventory, it's called JP01, and it has three hosts and two groups or whatever. Okay, so you create that within Ansible AWX database. This is very, very flexible, highly flexible and highly dynamic, as a highly sort of changing thing, and it's a little bit, it takes a little bit getting used to compared to command line, but really very nice. And these inventories, for example, when you have an inventory which you create locally, or also here, I've got a host file, but an Ansible inventory sourced in via a Git repository, or here we have hosts, for example, groups, hosts, sources, and you see here the hosts and individual variables, or rather groups that we have there. Okay, so that's a little bit what the whole thing looks like. Next to inventories, we have projects, and projects contain jobs, and a project is basically a collection of playbooks which originally could be placed on AWX file system. This is also still documented if you use, or if you plan on today using Ansible Tower. They still document the fact that you could place a playbook on a file system. Forget about that. That will not work anymore. I mean, it would work, but it It is designed to fail very soon because AWX and Tower systems can be clustered. And if they're clustered, they're running on different machines. So if we put the playbook or our inventory file on one host in a particular directory, I won't even tell you which directory it is, a particular directory, and the playbook is then actually run on a completely different machine of the cluster, how is that machine going to find the playbook? It just cannot, okay? So that is why I have stripped it through. It's still documented as works, and if you put it in the right place on all machines, it actually will work, but it's just useless, just forget about it. It's worthless. It's not worth your while thinking about how that could work. So typically, projects will be synchronized via a source control management system and create so-called job templates or workflows. I think I'll show you an example in a second. Now this job template or a job template, when it executes, a job template has a whole bunch of things. A job template is in a project, and a job template is associated with an inventory. And a job template is also associated with so-called credentials. Credentials specify in AWX mechanisms by which Ansible AWX can, for example, log into your service, be it with username and password, be it hopefully with an SSH key. Those Ansible AWX requires access to your private SSH key, which you import into AWX and is stored securely. It is encrypted locally. And Ansible AWX will then use that SSH key or use one of the SSH keys you specify to actually then tell Ansible or Ansible Playbook how to log into a particular machine. And all these things, for example, here, this so-called machine credential has a name, the playbook that comes out of a repository, etc. This is what we see here. So here we have the job details as the job actually executes. When it started, when it finished, what the template name was, who launched it, which inventory it comes out of, which project it comes out of, the revision of the project. What could that be? What does that look like to you?
Git commit.
Yeah, in this case, exactly, a git hash, thank you. Playbook, machine credentials, etc. And then here on the right-hand side, quite nice, if you ask me, is the output as we would see it on the console when running Ansible Playbook. Okay, same color, you see the green, the yellow, the red. First of all, on the top, this bar is also changes in color, so green, orange, red. You see how many plays were done, how many tasks in this play were done, how many hosts, and the elapsed time. Technically, you will at one stage here later on be able to download standard out and standard error. That is currently not possible, but it is planned to happen. The download button is already there, it just doesn't work. These tasks here, you see, can be collapsed. Okay, you can collapse them. You can search for tasks, and now comes something that is very sexy, and is really very sexy. The okay, or the changed, or the host, you can click on them. What we see here is not static, it's live, it crawls. You can click on that, and then comes a pop-up which shows you the actual JSON that was produced when that task was run. Okay, now that is really very sexy. So we see actually even more than we would when we run Ansible Playbook. Respectively, we see what we get what we would see when we run Ansible Playbook minus between 1 and 17 these. I can't remember. So that is really very nice. And the reason why that is, I'll try and explain in a moment, but that is very elegant. It does at the moment give an impression of being a little bit not slow, but a little bit sort of jumpy. The reason is the technology that's behind it to be able to produce that is quite impressive. Yes, sir.
Do you also see, you said to see more than running from the command line? But if you run very close to the command line,
Yes.
JSON output also.
Yes, exactly. You get JSON, but you have to remember when you launch the playbook, you have to remember to say verbose.
Okay.
Here, I didn't even have to do that. On the contrary, you'll see here on the left, there's a second verbosity which I can set when I create the task. When I create the job template, I can say, please run in verbosity, normal, high, debug, etc. But I've left it on normal, and I can still then click in there and see the debug output. Okay?
So we have the task verbose.
Yeah.
When you say normal.
Then we have a job list, which is also accessible top left from the dashboard. This job list also changes dynamically as soon as somebody kicks off a job. You'll see the job show up here. This job list indicates the job, what type of job it was, when it finished. Then, of course, what kind of a job it was and whether it failed or whether it's successful. Impossible to see here. These blobs here, they pulse. They are kind of a gray and not gray and white and not white until they turn either green or red. And it just indicates to us that something's happening, that the system is moving, that things are happening. And if we look very carefully here, you will notice that question, which was the last job that I kicked off? What's the name of that job?
Probably J1.
I asked the wrong question. Which was the, after the last failure, sorry, which was the first job that I kicked off? Obviously.
128.
T job, the 128. Okay, so that was a playbook run. I kicked off a job template, and behind that is a playbook run. And that automatically kicked off an SCM update and an inventory sync, because in my job template, respectively in my project, when I set up the project and when I set up the job template, I said, as soon as this job template, this playbook is launched, recall, please, that we have already said job templates obtain their playbooks and their inventories via Git. I want to make sure that this playbook runs for the latest revision that is pulled from Git. So I kick off the playbook run, and that brings behind it the SCM update for the project, and then an inventory sync for the inventory that I'm using. Okay, so I can decide how up to date I want to be. This, of course, means that every time that we launch this, Ansible AWX has to check with Git whether there's a new commit. If there is a new commit, it does a Git pull. If there isn't, then it leaves it right now. We also have workflows. Workflows are job workflows contained in the project. And job workflows allow us to do a little bit of, job workflow. So here's an example. We have a job template called P1, and if this is successful, it will initiate a second job behind it. And there can be any number of such jobs sort of chained together. We see here at the top again, total number of jobs 2, and we see a color. Green was okay, red was not okay. Yeah, so it's relatively elegant, if you ask me. And these jobs, one job can go to the next, and here, I've kept this very simple, but I could here, for example, at the end of one job template say, if this is successful, do this job, else do another job. Okay.
Can you embed this in your project to define it like a check file or a trash file if you want to have a certain...
Interesting question. No, I do not think that is currently possible. So this is, it's in the project, but I can't describe this, let's say, as YAML and then provided via Git, if that's what you mean. So that is not possible. But it is, of course, in my AWX project. Yeah? So it's in the database.
Can you run them parallel also?
Say again?
Can you run job workflows parallelly?
Well, you can run two different workflows in parallel.
Didn't the workflow have two jumps at the same time and then come back?
I don't know. I don't think so, but I don't know.
So it's actually just roles? It's just the logic of the roles in a workflow?
No, I didn't. No, no, I didn't say role. I said playbook. Because where's the role?
In
the playbook. So what we're launching in workflows, what we're launching are Ansible AWX job templates, which are our playbooks, and those playbooks, of course, can use roles. Yes?
And a particular inventory per
per job template, correct. And I'm being probably a huge pain in the ass by using this language, job template. The reason I'm doing it is that when I first got in touch with Tower, I thought that was the most difficult thing about Tower and also about AWX is the language, okay? The fact that we can't just kick off a playbook. No, it's called a job template, and a job template is in a project and it's associated with an inventory. After a few hours, maybe 1 hour, after a few hours, you realize it's logical and it becomes logical. But without this initial specification of the language, I found it very difficult. That's why I'm trying to help you along.
I won't have free of charge. That this project, this product, is designed to use with multiple teams,
yes,
with multiple levels of access, with different authority or jurisdictions over inventory hosts. So once you know that, you can set up teams with admins or teams with support desk operators.
Oh, of course, yes.
And that kind of thing, it's an enterprise.
Correct, and not only that, so even one level higher with several organizations. So you can have different, in the German word is Mandant, different, what you call when you have different
organizations.
Yeah, organizations, it's called. In banking software, it's called, or in HR, you call them...
Human resources.
What's it called in German?
Mandant.
Mandant. Mandants. Tenants.
Tenants, thank you. Yeah. That's it.
What the TVN?
sticker.
Yeah, so we have organizations, you have teams, you have users, and in those users or in the user categories, you have administrators, normal users, and you also have auditors. Auditor is a user who is more or less a little bit like a normal user. He's allowed to see logs. He may not execute jobs. Okay, so an auditor cannot change anything. Can look, but not touch. And that is the granularity of the authorization system. A role-based system in Ansible AWX.
And the auditor role is the web screen files observed in banks.
Yes, that's why I'm only telling you, I'm not telling anybody else. Okay, we have the possibility in Ansible AWX to configure logging here with an example log stash, so detailed or more or less detailed logging of every single step, everything that happens in Ansible AWX. Now, the reason being, Ansible being what it is, and Ansible having been created the way it is, and having been contributed to by so incredibly many people. Number one, I think in this room is probably Dahvir, some you all know. Then lots of contributors. Who has contributed to Ansible? Yeah, oh yeah, Serge, of course, Serge, a whole lot, Toshan, Ton, yeah. What was I talking about? Something about logging. Due to the way that Ansible is and due to the way that Ansible was created and what it can do now, you might or might not know about callback plugins. We can modify Ansible in such a way on the fly without actually touching the code by adding plugins and in different levels. So for example, inventory plugins or inventory scripts, and today inventory modules, but also callback plugins. And these callback plugins can access every instant or every instance and every each entry point in a playbook, in a play, in a task, task in, task out, task success. And AWX uses exactly this mechanism by adding callback plugins, which actually pick up the data and then transport it back into AWX, respectively to a logging system. And here, an example, a tiny little thing that I did by configuring Logstash. And there are, of course, other logging mechanisms, like, for example, aggregator server like Splunk, Logly, Sumo Logic, Elastic, Elk. And in AWX, you can configure these. There's a settings area at the bottom. You can say, I want logging to Splunk, and you set up your whatever it is, user ID and URL, whatever, and off you go. Okay? So that's all built in. Here, this example with Logstash and the Elk stack. Then, just as we have in, I call it normal Ansible, in AWX, we also have notifiers. Not all of them have been implemented, but lots of them have. And the reason that these are a little bit special is there is UI, there is user interface for these. So you can configure mail or Slack or Twilio, IRC, PagerDuty, HipChat, and webhooks. Webhooks, of course, you can do whatever you like with them. So there's a user interface for this, and notifiers can be inherited. So you can have a notifier, for example, on an inventory, and that notifier, if and when it fires on an inventory, it will also fire on a playbook or job template, as we call it, which uses that inventory which you've given execute right to Jane to. So when she runs that playbook or that template that she only has execute right to, it will also fire the notification that was configured for the inventory. So that is really quite nicely done. Credentials, we've spoken about already, or I've mentioned already, we have credentials for SSH, those are so-called machine credentials. Let me show you one in a moment. Machine credentials. Then you have credentials for Amazon, for Google, for your version control system, for example, Git or Mercurial, whatever. You have credentials which you can use for Vault. What is meant by this?
Ansible Vault.
Careful if you ever see that or use it, you'll think there's something missing here because you only ask for a password. And the only thing you set up in AWX for Ansible Vault is the password. The actual vaulted file you set up in your locally in your playbook directory and push it into your repository. Okay. And then when AWX kicks off the Ansible playbook, Ansible will then see, oh, I've got a YAML file, for example, which has been vaulted. And will then check, has AWX given me a vault credential? Yeah, okay, I can unpack it and use it. Yeah. Yes, sir?
Is it possible to have multiple vaults passwords?
No.
It is not possible
in plain Ansible either. So that's why not.
Okay.
What is anything, well, I might be lying to you, but I cannot think of anything that Ansible does not have, which AWX has. So if Ansible can't do it, then AWX can't do it either.
But if you have multi-tenancy, then you need to share the vault path.
Yeah, I beg your pardon. I understood you as asking that question for one job template.
Okay, so it's on project mode.
Correct. Oh, you can have 57,892 vault passwords. Okay, and you can have as many machine or group. I understood for one job template. That is not possible. Okay, Mark, you said something. Right. But of course, if all of us are running against one AWX installation, then of course we have n machine credentials, we have n vault credentials, etc. But in our job template, ergo in our playbook, we can only access or use one vault file. Okay. Same goes for machine credentials. Different is so-called custom credentials. With custom credentials, very nicely done, in my opinion anyway. Custom credentials, I can create I can create a system whereby I here's an example. Create a credential called lunch access for a particular organization, and this uses a credential type called pasta, which I created. So we create a custom credential type, which I've called pasta. And this custom credential type, which I created in AWS, I'm now creating a credential which will use that custom type. And this credential that I'm creating is called lunch access. And that pasta has three fields in it. One field is called UID, it's mandatory, that's the way I defined it. One field is called password, it's also mandatory. And one field is called which type of pasta would you like, and it's a multiple choice. Look, I entered rice, and AWS says rice is not one of spaghetti, fettuccine, or whatever, girandole. Okay? So, okay. Somebody, one of us, an admin for example, has created custom credential types, and I will be using this now in a new job template for a new Ansible playbook run, which I want. And I need the user ID, and I need the password, and I need the pasta type. And when Ansible then AWS kicks off Ansible and invokes my playbook, I can then define a little bit prior, I can define how I want to get this information. Yeah, I need that in my playbook, okay? I need it. Maybe I want it in a Jinja template, maybe I want it in a file, whatever. And I can ask for environment variables. I can ask for I can ask for environment variables, and I can ask for a file. So the same any type file or YAML type file or whatever, to be able to access these credentials. So that is quite powerful. Yes, Bas, and then, yeah.
So I would like to have one-time tokens, because RSA tokens are quite common, and the other one is client certificates.
Yeah.
Are they supported as well?
Well, Monday evening, together with documentation pull requests, I will expect the pull request from you.
Yeah.
No. Currently not. Well, client certificates, of course, client X509 certificates, in theory you could, because you could have a text area, we just paste them in, okay? And then have a password, passphrase, which you would call, to actually unlock the thing. But that is not something that AWS would do for you now, but what we could certainly implement that. A one-time token, so an RSA token, I don't think we nothing occurs to me at the moment how to do
that. Open ID, right?
Yeah.
Authentication with open ID.
There's no support for that at the moment. But it would be, that would probably be worth a ticket on the issue tracker as an idea to implement it.
Well, if you support the authentication via Google,
yeah,
then you can set up to a pay on Google and then
okay. To be honest, first of all, I've never used Google authentication. And second of all, I would never, ever, I would fall dead before I would recommend to a client to use anything like that in a closed environment. So for me, it's completely taboo. I wouldn't even touch it.
Now, what's the protocol behind it?
Yeah.
I have almost the same question, but is it possible to use a two-factor authentication module? So if you know something, but you get a one-time password generated by some other application, for instance, Google Authenticator, is it interactively possible to implement that? Because if you put it in here, it's used once, it's fire and forget.
Yes, yes, that is possible. In all things, wherever we ask for credential, when we configure a job template, when we say use that project, that inventory, use these variables, these extra variables. I hope to show you an example in a second. You can also say prompt on launch. So we can also, later on, when we actually use this new credential that we're creating here, we can say, well, if it's specified in the job template, then use it. Otherwise, please prompt the user, okay? So theoretically, almost all things, yes, you can prompt on launch.
In the tower, the license tower, at least in the two dot something, you had forms.
Yes, they're called surveys in AWS and they exist. Yeah. A survey. I'll tell you. Please remind me to tell you in a second if I don't show you. This here is a form for a machine, what is called a machine credential. AWS calls it a machine credential. In our language, it's an SSH credential. So this has a name, it has everything, has a description which you can look at. And once again, everything we see here also has an API, and so we can also create these things by API. Okay, we can use curl to actually create, put this in here. Be a little bit careful if you start transporting your SSH private key passphrases via unencrypted curl, but anyway, that's your problem. And so we have a credential type of type machine. You see here a field, a text area for SSH private key. That's why I've pasted in my private key.
I hope that's not your private key.
I beg your pardon?
I hope that's not your private key.
It's only part of it. It's all of it. Yeah. No, it's not. It's obviously a test private key.
Yeah, you
it's your private key.
Let's try it.
That's right. Don't you paste it in your private key? And then you have the passphrase. Here's an example. You have to specify the passphrase, and Ansible will then take this passphrase, store it locally, and encrypt it locally. Okay, it is put into a database, but in an encrypted form, and basically only AWS can decrypt it. Now, what happens is that this private key, respectively its passphrase, will never be put on disk in decrypted form. When the playbook actually then runs, when AWS kicks off Ansible with the drop template, AWS will see, okay, I need a machine credential. That's the way the project has been set up. It goes, gets the machine credential. It goes, gets the passphrase that was entered, decrypts this passphrase, and then feeds the key to Ansible, respectively to Ansible on the run. Okay. And here's an example of what I was talking before. I don't want, for example, to store my passphrase. Maybe somebody's scared or just doesn't want to commit the passphrase to a key into Ansible. It's fine. And you can click on prompt on launch. And that would mean the key is stored. And when the job is kicked off, then AWS will prompt us for the passphrase for that key. Which, of course, has a slight disadvantage. Which?
You cannot run not interactively.
Yeah, must be run interactively. Okay. And we'll see in a second that is a great disadvantage. So, webhooks. I mentioned earlier we had webhooks, of course, incoming in form of REST API. And we also have outgoing webhooks. We can configure a URL with HTTP headers, etc. And Ansible will, as a notifier, use this webhook wherever you want, wherever you can use a notifier. You can also use webhooks. Okay, that's sort of a little bit about what we see in the user interface, the capabilities of AWS. You need a bit of imagination to figure out how it works. But if you know Ansible, if you know Ansible playbooks, then all these bits and pieces should more or less fit in. Here, a little slide on how clustering will work. Clustering for AWS is not completely ready, but it will work this way. What we see here in the center, most of these bits already exist, but sort of only for one. What we have is an HTTP server, Nginx, with a UWSGI, which actually picks up whatever we an API request or picks up our web browser request. And that is passed on to the internals of AWS, which is basically RabbitMQ and Python Celery for the job task distribution. Although the AWS team has created a special task manager, which runs on top of Celery. And all this is within an AWS host and is backed by Postgres. Okay. Now, when AWS machines are hosts are clustered, what we will have is then multiple of these, but this part in the middle, that is what will actually be doing the clustering, or basically RabbitMQ is what will be actually used as sort of a cluster backend between the individual AWS hosts, and they will share a single PostgreSQL backend. In this PostgreSQL database, what you have is everything that we've created, so our playbooks, our projects, our inventories, the synchronized inventories, facts, everything, workflows, credentials, obviously, are stored in Postgres, and also any playbook results, so any job template that has run with all the tasks and the results of those tasks is also stored, or are also stored in Postgres. Only that is important because imagine we kick off a job template and it runs on AWS host 1, and then somebody goes to host, logs in mistakenly, or because it's taken that way by the load balancer, logs in on host 2, wants to see the result of playbook number 1 on host 1. Okay, so that's why everything is in the database itself. So there's a REST API. This REST API allows us, obviously, to do everything. We can kick off here the job template by name. I pass in the extra variables, for example. I can create a user, API v2 users, create a user, username JOG1, first name Joanne, guest, email, password. So this is your typical curl command to actually create a user. Is there anybody here? I was asked last week. Is there anybody here who doesn't know Joe? Joe is a little utility which creates JSON from a.
Last week I didn't. Last week I didn't.
This is actually quite nice, Joe, because Toshan can use it to convert some of his playbooks. It doesn't.
What do you mean exactly by quite nice?
It's a work of art.
It doesn't produce
yes,
Yodel, well. Does it?
No, but somebody last week said, why don't you create a Yo with a Y, Y-O,
yeah,
to produce YAML? And I said, no, I can't, because the name is already taken. Remember that app, that Yo app? Somebody created an app called Yo. The only thing the app does is
send you.
That's all it did. And that app, I think overnight, had 1 million downloads or something like that.
You can still take it, because it's
a
command line utility.
But I actually looked the this. There's several libraries for creating YAML, but it's so awful. Maybe one day if I have time.
If you
otherwise
have JSON, it shouldn't be that hard.
Yes, it shouldn't be. Hey, yeah. Create a JSON and then convert it.
Just append another pipe to JSON to YAML.
So it's yo-yo.
Yo-yo. Very good. Tower CLI or Tower CLI is a little utility produced also by the Ansible team. This is fully open source and basically wraps the REST API into a command line thing. And this command line, it's not bad at all. Actually, it's for something it's quite nice. If you look at this here, if we do curl to launch this job template and you know that in an Ansible playbook, you can specify with minus E or minus minus extra vars, you can specify additional variables which are given to the playbook at runtime. You can also specify JSON files or YAML files with minus E. And if you look at how this is done here, it's quite ugly. No? You have to escape all sorts of stuff, and it's really not very elegant. And the nice thing about TowerKey is, if we use TowerKey here to job launch with minus minus job template, the template name, whoever created this syntax ought to be shot, because why isn't it job launch just job name? But okay, it's this way. Then TowerKey asks AWX, are there any mandatory extra variables? And if so, it kicks us into an editor and gives us a YAML file with predefined extra variables that have been defined in the playbook, which I just fill in, save whatever, out of whichever editor I'm in, save the result, and TowerKey then kicks off the job with the required parameters. And I see then ID with under ID number 152, there's job template number 8, which was created and status is pending, and I can go back and ask whether status is finished, etc. I have to shut up now. Okay, totally cool. Totally cool. Provisioning callbacks. Many people have wanted this. Toshan earlier showed you a diagram which showed Ansible in so-called pull mode. By default, Ansible is in push mode. That means that when we run Ansible, and the same goes for AWX and the Ansible it uses, when we run Ansible, it's from a master, whatever the master is, we push out configuration, okay? And for many organizations, that is just not viable, be it for any, whatever, security rules, or be it for the simple fact that they have just too many machines. They can't push it out, they can't go through tens of thousands of machines, it's just completely impossible. So they would install and configure Ansible in pull mode. And what I've experienced very frequently is that people say, can we have both? Well, yes, of course you can have both. But the disadvantage of Ansible in pull mode is that you have to install Ansible on the node, which is one exactly contradicts one of the huge strengths, in my mind anyway, of Ansible, is that we do not have to install anything on the nodes. We don't have to have an agent on the nodes. Okay? The provisioning callback in AWX allows us to specify for a particular job template, allows us to create a so-called provisioning callback, and what we do is we create a host configuration key, and this is just a word. Ansible AWX will create one for you, or as many as you like for you, just a word. And what we can then do from, because we now have a system, a centralized system, AWX, which has access to our playbooks, to our job templates, our inventories, it has access to everything, to our keys, okay? What we can now have is, I'm going to step a little bit aside, and now I'm a node, Mark gets a fit, but I have to, I'm a node, I can now, from this node, issue a curl command, or issue an API request with that host configuration key to AWX. AWX then, Mark, go back, AWX then, looks at this configuration key, checks whether the host that is requesting that is actually in the inventory and set up for this template, and if so, will start provisioning that host. Okay, so it's a provisioning, it's still a push provisioning, but kicked off, initiated by the host itself. And this initiation can happen, for example, in first boot, can happen in a kickstart file, can happen from cron periodically, as however you want. Yeah? So that, to my mind, is something really very nice.
In fact, you trigger from the node, you trigger a Ansible run on the master.
Quite correct. So from the node, you trigger, in our language, from the node, you trigger a playbook run from the master. Yeah? From the node, you trigger a job template run. The job template run takes an inventory, checks whether that host is in it, so it's authenticated also, and only if that host is in it will actually then kick off for that single host, will kick off a push, will kick off a deployment.
So you schedule on the host that it needs this run?
Yes.
But you can schedule it also
in AWX now? Correct. In AWX, yes. Thank you for mentioning that. I haven't said so yet. In AWX, we have a scheduler, sort of a glorified cron thing where we can say, please run these job templates every whatever. Correct. But what we, that is scheduling for something that you want to do periodically. So you would maybe once an hour want to run your job template. But this will also work, for example, for hosts that just come out from bare metal. Yeah, in a kickstart file, or what's it called in with Debian? First boot of
pre-seed. Pre-seed.
Pre-seed.
Pre-seed, thank you. Yeah. You can initiate a deployment from your AWX server by pasting it in. Okay? And that's what many people have wanted. Yes?
So the data value is taken as a variable inside the playbook that's been triggered off.
The host config key, well, first of all, we have a job template here. That's the template that will be used, of template number 11, but not specified by name. Sorry, I should have done that. And the host config key is sent by the node to AWX. AWX verifies whether that host config key actually matches the host config key that you as an administrator set up for that particular job template. Okay? So none of us want that some box that Tom suddenly brings up and he guesses the correct URL to my AWX server, I don't want that he can ask my AWX server to deploy SAP HR onto his machine because he doesn't belong to me. So that's what the host key is for, that authenticates us and his host name, respectively. Yeah, his host name must be in my inventory. Only if those two things match, and the job template exists, of course, only if those three things match, will my AWX actually deploy to his machine.
I thought that key was created on the fly during...
No, that key is created in AWX.
Yeah, and then you set the key, and then you type in the key in your pre-seed file or in your...
Yes, correct, file. Correct.
And, ah, okay.
Correct.
Yeah, okay.
But, hang on a second. Let's say this is live, okay? And you find this. If you copy out that command, and you launch that command against my AWX, I will say, no, you can't have it. Because your host name doesn't match, for example. Bas had it, actually.
Yeah, so I typically create an image with Packer and I store it on Azure. And then when the VM is instantiated for whoever wants to use it, they would want that host to call back and do the provisioning, maybe only checkout that runs the pull mode progressively. This host key is embedded in an image, right? So it's hard to make it a variable, or I could do something with a script that takes the MAC address or so. Or
stop, I don't think I've made myself clear. This one host config key is not for that machine.
Yeah, it's for authentication.
It's an authentication against my AWX server for one job template.
Okay. But it can work with the dynamic inventory.
Oh, sure. It can work with any type of inventory. That's irrespective of that. Whoa. Let me have a seat. Yes, you were first.
If I want to have a cluster of machines, can I reuse this host key?
Yes.
So, in general, it's for provisioning like a Pixabay template for all my, for instance, web watching machines.
Correct. That one host key will ensure that one template is run against whichever host asks for it. So, we have one template for installing SAP HR, we have another template for installing Nginx. We would issue, at the very least, two different host keys.
So it's more like a template key than a host key.
It is definitely a template key. Yeah, that's why I think they call it a host config key. It's not host key. It's a host config key. It's a
credential for a certain job.
It's a key.
And then the machine, the AWX machine, will find this host in the inventory or not, and if it is not in the inventory, it will fail.
The HTTP request comes in, obviously HTTPS also possible, the HTTP request comes in, the AWX server does a reverse DNS lookup, tries to match the host name, checks the host name against all inventories which are configured for this job template. Now careful, this can, for example, also mean that it takes a few seconds because this can mean oh, this job template uses a project. That project has update via SCM on launch, so it has to run a Git checkout. It has to run an inventory sync. It can take a while, no? I mean, it can take a few seconds. So against any inventory, and if your hostname is in my inventory used by this job template,
and you have
then,
you, then
and you have it, then you get the result. Yeah. And now shut up. Yeah, carry on. Yeah.
So for example, if you do a pixie boot, you need to configure the hostname first.
Can be dynamic.
Why did I mention this? If I do a pixie boot, then you have to configure a hostname.
So
can I have Josh, can I have an IP address in inventory? No. Yes, I can.
Yeah.
I can. Yeah. Then the answer is no.
You can even have regular well file name expression.
Yeah, yeah, there.
Like thingies in the.
Yeah.
You can create a subnet regular expression in your inventory.
Don't exaggerate this, guys. Don't exaggerate. You had a
the question I have is, if you put this in the setup and someone tries to, he gets the host config key and he tries something, do you get a notification from that?
No, no. You can check in the logs. Yeah, you can check in the logs. The client, if you run curl-v, so if you look whatever you run, if you look at the headers that come back, you will see, I think a 403 or something, authentication or permission denied. 401.
Do you get it in your AVX or?
You can, well, the client gets a header back saying, no, forget it. Yep, you're not allowed. And the, on server side, it's logged somewhere. I forget exactly where, but it's logged somewhere.
Yeah,
it could.
If you have an addition or something.
It could result in a mini denial of service.
Yeah.
Are there any more questions to provisioning callbacks?
No.
Good. Can we now please continue? Thank you.
Yes.
No, I'm really just kidding, because this, to my mind, is one thing that makes AWS really quite sexy, or even sexier than earlier, because we suddenly have, things which we can now really do with Ansible. Don't get me wrong, we could, if you muck around enough, you could do this today also, of course, manually. But now we have a framework, a more or less documented framework, which actually allows us to do things like this. And that that I know for a fact are things that some people have really been wanting to have. This is nothing special, just a little reminder we have Tower, AWS and Tower on the one hand, and AWS and Tower have an API. So what we can, for example, do here again, things, this is not something that you couldn't do so far. You can also use, for example, Git hook or something. But if you have an SCM, be it Git or Mercurial, Bitbucket, whatever they're all called, you can set up. You might have your playbooks in GitHub, for example. You can set up from your SCM a webhook publish on commit, and that webhook would be kicked off. That would trigger the API, tell Ansible Tower to run that playbook, to run that job template. That job template is checked in as please always check with the SCM. So AWS would automatically pull out the playbook and maybe the inventory and launch. So just a simple commit to your SCM would kick off AWS with your correct playbook.
Directly on production.
Yes, absolutely.
I beg your pardon?
Directly on your production environment.
Of course.
Yeah, of course.
Are you a wimp or something?
I'm just
saying these are things that suddenly become possible. Okay. Whether they are a good idea. Okay. Right. I have to now really cut it down, and I will very quickly. The only thing that you are probably not going to like about AWS, that is the fact that currently it can only and exclusively be installed using either Docker or OpenShift, which uses Docker. OpenShift or MiniShift are both more or less the same. And of course, what we need is PostgreSQL. To be fair, there are many people who want to install AWX and also the other combinations. If you join the IRC channel, which is called Ansible-AWX, you'll see every few minutes somebody said, can I? No. These are the supported mechanisms. And the installation instructions in the AWX repository describe and define exactly these two installation methods, local Docker and OpenShift MiniShift. And in both cases, what you might find interesting, I thought it was rather cool actually, is installation of AWX occurs with Ansible. Yeah, and the configuration happens in an inventory file. The inventory file is just a single line at the top, and then all colon vars, and you have the variables which define where Postgres is and what type of logos you want, etc., etc., etc.
I would expect Origin instead of OpenShift, since AWX is the open source upstream.
You would have
Origin is the upstream project of OpenShift, so I would expect Origin to be.
Oh, I am not. I think I know what you're talking about, but that's the extent of my knowledge. I am not particularly firm with these things. I got some help from Karambi Singh, who helped me a little bit with OpenShift, and then I scrapped that because it didn't do what I thought it should do. What works very well, or what has worked very well so far for me, is the local Docker installation. That really sent us. And you run the playbook, and that works really very well. With OpenShift, I had my troubles with OpenShift, but it's probably my problem.
No. Everybody has
okay.
Struggles with OpenShift. Sometimes it lasts more than a year.
A little bit more internals. This is a diagram that I have redrawn. Based on something that Matt, what's his name, did. So we have the entry point into AWX, the AWX server. This is the entry point for our web browser, this is the entry point for API. And then it goes into the UWSGI and the Django framework. We have PostgreSQL and RabbitMQ. RabbitMQ for the clustering when we then later on get more hosts. On the other side, this is sort of what is called AWX Web, and this is what is called AWX Task. You always have at least two hosts, so also when we install via Docker, we have at the very least two machines, and actually we have more. We have Docker running PostgreSQL container, an AWX Web container, AWX Task container, a RabbitMQ container, Memcached container, and something, there's one missing, I think. So these are all individual machines or individual containers. And Celery is the Python Celery. The task manager was created by Ansible to control Celery. Now the reason is the guys of Ansible wanted to make sure that, for example, 20 people say run this task, that not this task is run 20 times in parallel, because doing one thing 20 times in parallel is probably not going to work on one host. Okay. And for example, if 20 of us say, run this task, and this task has this playbook task has a pull from Git, why should we do that 20 times? It's going to fail. Yeah? We're going to clobber each other's things. So that is what this task manager does, is make sure that tasks that are launched quasi simultaneously are sort of, that one of them starts to actually do things like git pull, get the inventory, synchronize the inventory, things like that, and then the others come behind. But the actual work is then done by Celery. Then we have here callback receivers and fact cache receivers. These callback receivers are things that the callback plugins, which get the results from Ansible playbook runs, each individual task, task stop, task start, task whether it was successful, and they give, and also fact, they take that back drop it into RabbitMQ. RabbitMQ distributes it to the other machines, and of course then it lands back in PostgreSQL, from which it can then be refreshed and at a subsequent time later on then maybe deleted. I have this slide at the back, and I have to read more of this. Gets me terribly, this upsets me terribly. I don't know why. This is the current official artwork for Ansible AWX. No, not official. This is the current open source artwork for Ansible AWX. And if you use, if you install AWX, you get that angry potato. And for some reason, I call it the angry potato. It's called, they call it a spud. Spud is an old English word for potato. Something spud. It's got all sorts of names. And for some reason, somebody at Ansible or at Red Hat, I don't know, created this and deploys it together with AWX. Now, this got me horrendously upset. And you can either clone this in parallel to your AWX installation before running the installer playbook, and then you get a nothing logo, so it's empty, it's nothing on it at all. I've just broken your... And told you get play anyway. Or you, in the inventory script, you say you want the official logos, and then you get the new sort of AWX, whatever logo. Try not to have this, particularly not if you live in a civilized country and have to work with clients. That just doesn't cut it, to my mind anyway. Right, so I wish you all safer automation and great fun with AWX. It's worth your while having a look at it. I would like to repeat something that I said earlier. I myself would not like to have to use it, because anything that makes me click, I detest. I'm a command line person. But this is grand, AWX and Tower, really grand for certain environments, for certain customers, for certain situations. Like you have a playbook and you say, okay, I need first level support to be able to press a button and have that playbook run. Yeah, for that, AWX and or its commercial counterpart called Tower, which at a certain time will be the same code base, are really excellent. Who's seen this cake before? I am highly disappointed.
It was on your own blog. Where is it? Where is it?
I'm highly disappointed. Tom, give me another minute. I have to explain. Okay. This is a photo of a cake. It's a large cake. It was this size, which I created after I very, very successfully with Ansible deployed a Sudoers file onto approximately 500 machines. There was a comma at the end of one of the lines in the Sudoers file. And I don't know whether you knew that, but if you have a syntax error in the Sudoers file, then sudo refuses to operate, which is a clever thing to do. But if you've just distributed a Sudoers file to the machine with Ansible, that's the last step you will ever do on that machine. So what we had to do, this was at a customer site in Frankfurt, what we had to do, well, I couldn't go home, and the customer got 495, I have 473, can't remember, envelopes out of the safe, and we connected via HP ILO to these machines. I typed the root passwords, did then vi/etc/sudoers, line 17 at the end, remove the comma, save it back. And as a small apology that this happened, I then, a week later when I returned to the customer, brought this cake, which I'd had baked at a bakery at home. And this cake got a certain amount of fame. If you Google for sudo cake, I think the first hit of that is this cake. It got a certain amount of fame because it. I understand it. It's relatively seldom that somebody who really causes total crap actually writes about having caused total crap. But that's one reason. And reason number two Brian Cocker, who also got to hear about this, said, oh, you templated the sudo result, how about we add a validate command to it? And this validate command then, I think, appeared on the scene 3 hours later. This validate command did exactly that, was able to have a file templated or copied out to a Renault node, have a program on the other end validate, see whether this file works, whether it's okay, and only then install it at the end. That's the story of this kick. Thank you very much. I think there's bit now.
You can still laugh.
You can still, even if you validate the file, you can still lock yourself out,
yes,
in a valid way. Eh?
Of course.
The same is true for managing your SSH config file. You can also lock yourself out, and you can also easily, there's an example in the in the template file, I think, with for OpenSSH.
The great thing about any configuration management system is you can configure yourself, but you can also really
configure yourself out of it.
Fuck it up. Very quickly. Yeah. And in large
it's
scale.
Also again, yeah. It's also a nice thing to put in headers. So if you have a change in Nginx or so, you can put Nginx-T in your handler so that you first verify if your config is okay before you relaunch the web server of your major.
And Peter, of course, you get the same way as passage. But as a personal gift of me and to you, I brought you real Dutch sambal. Indonesian sambal, made by the local. No. I bought it at the local store. They make the best sambal bajak ever. It's not the very spicy one, but the little milder one. Yeah, I know. That's why I brought you the little gift.
Thank you very much. What's first one?
It's a tiny amount.
It's nice for cakes.
That's not for cakes.
Okay.
Yeah, you
want
to try?
Thanks
a lot. I think you're right.
Yeah.